To repeat that. Good morning. Good morning. What makes it so good is that God has graced us, has blessed us, has allowed us, literally has called us again to his presence in this place with his people where his spirit reigns. And where God's presence is, there's power. Where God's presence is, there's joy. Am I talking to somebody this morning? Where God's presence is, there's peace. And we're here to worship God who is all of that. And the reward of worship is the presence of God. And so we're grateful and thankful that he's given us this precious privilege to come together again one more time. And so the psalmist exhorts us, tells us, calls us to this worship. He says in Psalm 105, he says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the people." He says, "Sing to him. Sing praises to him. Tell of all his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice." Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. Remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles, and the judgments he's uttered. That's what the psalmist is telling us again this morning. And he's also saying, he tells us to do that, but then he goes on to say why in Psalm 100 verse 5. He says, "For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations." His faithfulness to all generations. The Lord is good. That's what the psalmist has told us and told us why. But here's what our children, here's what the kids told us this morning. They said that God is not dead. God is alive. Jesus rose and he lives. In me, if you know him, he lives in you. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say something. Let the redeemed of the Lord know that God is good. The Lord is good, and his mercies endure forever. He's blessed us to be here one more time, y'all. So let's get our minds right. Let's get our attitudes right. Let's get the spirit of the Lord that reigns in us focused, because God deserves all of our praise. He deserves all of our honor. His love endures forever. God, we ought to desire to serve and love God. Why? We ought to desire and serve God. Why? Because he's a so God. So, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. So, God is good and worthy to be praised. Here's another so. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. He lives. He lives. Jesus rose and he lives so that we are privileged to have eternal life presently. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you. We give you glory and we give you praise. We give you honor. We adore you. We exalt you. We lift up the name of Jesus. Name that is like no other name. Power in the name. Healing in the name. Salvation in the name. Love in the name. Protection in the name. Provision in your name, Lord. We just give you praise, glory, and honor. We thank you for all that you've done. We thank you for your obedience to the Father to come where you came from to do what only you can do here, and to go back after going through what you went through. So we just give you praise, glory, and honor. We ask that you continually be in our hearts and our minds to direct us, to guide us, to guard us, to give to us the ability and the commitment to love you and love others. And so we ask you, oh God, we just know we flourish in your presence. So we agree with you in your presence as we've come together to give you praise and glory and honor, and to remember you and what you've done, your ministry, your commitment, your obedience, your death, your burial, your resurrection, your ascension. We thank you for your promise. You're coming back because you're alive. You're coming back because you're good. You're coming back because your love for us. So we just praise you and lift you up. We ask that you would allow someone to come and grow, to come and accept you as the Lord and Savior, even this day, that they would know your goodness, your grace, and your mercy. You are Savior, and you save to the utmost. Thank you, God. We welcome you in our hearts and in our minds and in this place, bonded together in your love and your Holy Spirit. It's in the name of Jesus that we give you praise, glory, and honor. Amen. Amen. And as we continue, we invite you to give God praise and worship for expressions in praise. Amen.
Beside still waters, he restoreth my soul. When you become a believer, your spirit is made right, but sometimes the soul doesn't get the notice. It has a hole in it due to things that's happened in the past, hurt, abuse, molestation. But we want to speak to you today and tell you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul. Some people's actions are not because their spirit is wrong, but it's because the past has left a hole in their soul. May this wisdom help you get over your past and remind you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul. I have my sister Leandria here. She's going to help me share this wisdom and tell this story.
Cause all I seem to do is hurt me. Hurt me. Lord, deliver me. Cause all cause all I seem to do is hurt me.
Uh-huh.
Hurt me.
One more time.
Yeah. Lord, oh. Deliver me. Cause all
Background set. God rescued me from myself, from my overthinking. If you're listening out there, just repeat after me if you're struggling with your past and say, let the Lord know. Just say, oh. He wants to restore your soul. Just say,
deliver me.
Hey, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven. Break it on down. So it is. It is so. Amen. Now when we pray, I want to end that with a declaration, a decree. So I'm speaking for all of you listening, starting here, starting now. The things that hurt you in the past will control your future. Starting now, this is a new day. This is your exodus. You are officially released. Now sing it for me, Leandria.
Oh.
stand up and help us sing. Oh, how I love Jesus.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, oh, how I love Jesus.
Hallelujah, God.
Bless you. Yes.
Thank you for loving us, God.
Yes. Yes. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Bless his name.
You reach it.
God is a great God, and he's greatly to be praised. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we ought to rejoice. We ought to rejoice and be glad in it. For the psalmist said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. What a great day to be in the house of the Lord. We thank God for his presence. We thank God for his love. We thank God for his tender mercies. We thank God for you and your presence. We are grateful for those who are tuning in online. We just thank God for a wonderful day that he has blessed us with. I say happy Resurrection Sunday to each of you, and we celebrate what the Lord Jesus Christ has done. Yes, he died. Yes, he was buried. But the good news, anybody know the good news? He rose from the grave just like he said that he would. And we are grateful for that. Thank you. Thank you so much, worship leaders. Thank you so much for your leading us in worship. Expressions of Praise Mind Ministry. Thank you. Thank you. Amen. For opening us up. Thank you. And to all who were able to be with us or tune in with us on Holy Thursday, this past Thursday, thank you. Thank you so much. A wonderful way to celebrate and leading us unto this time together. Just in case you haven't had an opportunity to greet your neighbor next to you, just say good morning. It doesn't cost nothing. It doesn't hurt any. Nobody got hurt by saying good morning and a smile. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you. Thank you. Let's get right into the word. John 11. Praise God for all of these preachers and elders that are here. Praise God. They're always grateful for your presence. To all of our visitors and friends, thank you so much for being here. We know you could have chosen other places to be on today, but you chose to be at the Fresh Visions Community Church. So we praise God for you. John 11, a lot of reading, 16 verses, and then I'm going to jump down to 32 through 45. First 16 verses of John 11, and then verses 32 through 45, and I'm reading from the English Standard Version, John 11. And if you have your Bibles or your electronic device, I encourage you to turn there with me and then even leave it open as we'll be walking through some of these key verses. Now, a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. Verse 3, so the sisters sent to him, saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you. And are you going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not in him. Verse 11, after saying these things, he said to them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover. Now Jesus had spoken of this, of his death, but they thought that he meant taking rest in sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus has died. And for your sake, I am glad that I was not there so that you may believe. But let us go to him. So Thomas called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. Jump down to verse 32 through 45. Now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept, verse 35 says. So the Jews said, see how he loved him. But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind also have kept this man from dying? Verse 38, then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, by this time there will be an odor, for he has been dead 4 days. Verse 40, Jesus said to her, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around, that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. Verse 45, many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what he did, believed in him. So reads the word of God. Today I want to preach about a delayed response to not give up. A delayed response to not give up. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your people. Thank you, God, for this privilege. Thank you for this preaching hour. Speak, O God, as only you can, with clarity. To you be the glory, God. Thank you for what you're doing and what you will do. In Jesus' name, amen. A delayed response to not give up. In this Christian walk of life, we are urged not to give up or not to quit. We have either heard or used such words, such as tough it out, hang in there, be strong, see it through, it's gonna get better, or the likes. We certainly have used such statements with our children and with our grands and other youth in general, and with a hope that they will stay in school or excel academically and sometimes athletically. We want them to stick to it. Don't quit. I must admit, every so often there are two instances that come to my mind that I vividly recall that I didn't receive or listen to such encouragement from others or myself. As a teen, I recall two specific incidents where I didn't stick it out, where I quit and I later regretted it. I want to be transparent and share. Maybe this can help someone else in your own unique situation. Perhaps someone came in here ready to give up, ready to throw in the towel, ready to give up on God, maybe ready to give up on your marriage, ready to give up on your commitment. Someone may need to hear the word, do not give up. For me, the first time I was about 15 or 16 years old, I was working in a fast food business, working in a fast food restaurant in this city. And it was a summer job. I was still living in Mississippi, and I was here, was working, and I had worked and for almost 2 months, and then I had about 3 weeks to go before going back to school. And so I had saved a little money, but I thought it was a lot of money, but I had saved a little money. And so one night I wanted to be off. I can't remember what I wanted to do. And I asked the supervisor while I was working, could I get off? He says, no, you know, some people called in and it's busy, so I need you to stay. And so we talked about it a little bit, a couple of times, and then eventually I just made an impromptu decision. I got my time card and I checked out. And then, in essence, I quit my job and still had about 2 to 3 weeks to go. And so I realized how little the money was. If I wasn't getting another check and I was spending the little money that I had saved up. And so in essence, I regretted that I had quit. Besides that one decision, I figured I was a good employee. I showed up, I worked overtime as needed, did the extra stuff, you know how the job description says, other duties as assigned. I did all of that. So I decided that I would go back and ask the supervisor, the manager, if I could be rehired and work those extra 2 weeks before I return home to make a little bit more money so that I could take home with me. And so I made the decision to go back to this fast food restaurant place to talk to the manager about noon, the busiest time of the day, around noon, to talk to this manager. That's not a good idea, young people, to go talk to a manager around noon, the busiest time of the day, to request that I be hired or rehired back. And the manager, I talked to him for a little bit, and he made a decision right there on the spot. He says, no, I won't bring you back. After all, you're only going to be here 2 weeks. And so I made that decision. I later regretted that. The second decision that I remember that I quit, I was playing basketball my senior year in high school. I started the first game, and then my time began to decrease as the season went on. But yet I remembered the game. I was talking to some of my friends and relatives. One game in the county tournament, we were playing the championship game, and I made the winning shot. And people lifted me up, and they cheered, and I got a chance to say, hey, we're number one. The very next game, I didn't play 1 minute. The coach didn't even look my way, like, come sit beside me, like I might put you in. He didn't even look at me. In my mind, I began to formulate, I'm going to leave this team because some other things were going on, difficulty getting to practice and getting home after games and nature. To make a long story short, I quit the team my senior year of high school. And I remember, the coach pulling up because I didn't take the stuff back right away, but I stopped showing up. And he pulled up in his Coupe de Ville Cadillac. He let the window down. I'm standing out there with some other people. He says, bring my stuff back. And that's the clean version for the church. That was the said, bring my stuff back. I later regretted, because I wondered, what if I had talked to him a little bit more about playing times and developing myself, or perhaps talking to my dad and my mom about some other arrangements for practice and traveling. But I quit, and I regretted that I quit. Over the years, I've learned that just because everything is not how I think it should be doesn't mean that it's time to give up. Doesn't mean that it's time to quit. I've learned that just because the Lord doesn't respond immediately doesn't mean that it's time to give up or it's time to quit. I've learned that a delayed response could actually be the answer that I need not give up. Even as I trust that God is working it out for my good, even when it doesn't seem like it's for my good. And so here we are, John 11, a man named Lazarus who lived in a village called Bethany is sick. Bethany is some 2 miles from Jerusalem. Even though Jesus is not in Jerusalem at this time, it is believed that he's somewhere 25 to 30 miles away, which would be like a day's journey. Lazarus had 2 sisters, Mary and Martha. Some of you probably remember Mary and Martha. It was Mary in her worship, according to scripture, worship of Jesus, who anointed his feet with oil and wiped his feet with her hair. It was Mary who sat at the feet of Jesus to Martha's disappointment that she wouldn't come in the kitchen and help her. If I'm allowed to take a side road for a moment, it's a good thing to worship the Lord. I might need to say that again. It's a good thing to worship the Lord. In fact, Jesus told Martha when she was complaining about Mary sitting at his feet, he says she's doing a good thing. She's chose the right thing to do. And here's the other thing. The Lord welcomes you to use what he has blessed you with to honor and to glorify him. Your skills, your talents, your resources, they are all to be a blessing to him as you bless somebody else. Not only that, but regardless of what others think or say, it's a good thing to sit at the feet of Jesus. Amen, somebody. But everybody won't understand your transition from the person you used to be to the person you're trying to become. Everybody won't understand the transformation that God is making in you as you become more like Jesus. It's a good thing to become more like Jesus. Someone is tired of being the old person trying to do it on their own. Someone was ready to give up because you are sick and tired of being sick and tired. And I come with some good news today. Amen. The good news in Matthew 11, 28 and 30, where Jesus says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden." That means heavy loaded. He says, "And I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me." He says, "For I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy." He says, "You'll have some burden," but he says, "My burden is light." I appreciate the Lord welcoming us to come to him. Around the 1840s and 1850s, that was considered the gold rush era. Some of you are familiar with this. This was the gold rush era for the state of California, primarily the San Francisco area. Hundreds of thousands of men primarily were traveling to California to hit it big in finding gold. Unfortunately, what many found was pyrite. Somebody know about pyrite? It's also known as fool's gold. Somebody was awake in their history class. Although pyrite looked like gold, it really had no real value. And many of the men came there and dug and scratched and scraped for hours and days and months, only to go to try to get money for the pyrite, but was only disappointed because it had no real value. Why do I bring up something from the 1840s and 1850s? Because in 2024, we have to be careful that when the Lord doesn't respond how we think he should, that we begin to rush to a pyrite type God, to hear a pyrite type message. It's dangerous to rush to things and messages that only makes us feel good, but have no eternal value. We need the real gold. We need the real good news. And sometimes the good news doesn't make us feel good, but we need the truth of God's word. But apparently Mary and Martha felt that there was a special bond between Jesus and Lazarus. When Lazarus got sick, verse 3, they sent for him. And they said, "The one you love is sick," with the expectation that Jesus would immediately drop everything and rush to Lazarus' side. Don't miss the important point here. He loved Lazarus. Lazarus loved Jesus, but still Lazarus got sick. Sometimes people that Jesus loves get sick. It's a surprise to some. And yet Jesus loves the sick, and sometimes he doesn't immediately heal the sick, but it's not because he doesn't have healing power. Whatever he does it for a purpose. And whatever he allows for a purpose. He still has the power to heal and to restore, even if he chooses not to, or not to the way we think he should. And so he expected him to come. They expected him to come in a hurry. And I heard a preacher say, when we talk about visiting the sick, it's important, or even when we visit people when it's not a sad occasion, the preacher say, don't let the funeral home plan your family reunion. In other words, go see folks when they're doing good. Go to the happy occasion events. Everybody show up on the funeral. But he said, don't let the funeral home plan your family reunion. He says, they said, the one you love is sick. And the good news is that he loves all of us. He loves you and your mess and my mess. He loved us so much that he was willing to die for us. Loved us so much that God raised him from the dead with power. And the Bible says that when we believe this, we have been receive eternal life when we admit and acknowledge our sins, and then when we can welcome the Lord into our heart by believing what he said and believing the facts that he has given his life and he rose from the grave on our behalf. The writer John wants to make it clear that Jesus loved Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. And you can include your name. The Lord loves you and your family. He loves you. Even when we were messed up, he still loved us and loves us. But some may say, how could he love us, or how could he love me when he allows me to go through so much? Just because the Lord isn't responding the way you think he should doesn't mean he doesn't care or he doesn't know. He still cares and he knows. Verse 6, he heard Lazarus was sick, but then the strange thing says he didn't rush to them. He stayed 2 more days right where he was. He didn't even turn water into wine when his mother thought he should in John 2. He didn't rush to Lazarus' side because he says there was a greater plan and a greater purpose than just healing Lazarus. He says that the purpose, the plan, is that Lazarus would actually die. That was the greater purpose and the greater plan. And I don't understand everything that Jesus chooses to do, or I don't understand everything why God allows certain things to happen. I'm just learning and believing that it's important that I trust the Lord more than I understand or even agree with what the Lord is doing. I'm just called to trust that God got everything in his care, and everything is going to work out according to his plan. He didn't ask me for my recommendation. He didn't ask me about my ideas. I'm just learning to trust God. And I just encourage you to trust God. When he asks for your ideas and your opinion, he knows where to find you. He knows where to find me. Lazarus eventually dies. He didn't rush to their request. He didn't rush to their urgent message to come quickly. In fact, when he showed up, it was some 4 days that he had already been dead. Notice verses 23 through 27. Jesus says, because Mary and Martha, they were disappointed. And so here he says, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day. But Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. And someone may have wondered, why didn't he talk about him coming out of the grave in the scripture? Why we didn't read about him being on the cross? Well, I want to lead up to that. I'm sure I will touch on it. But right now, we just want to look at the fact that he raised Lazarus. He didn't show up when they wanted him to show up, but he did show up. Isn't that the good news? Someone says that he's seldom early, but he's never late. Some used to say that he's never late, but he's always on time. And so here it is, here it is. He shows up 4 days later at the grave, and he says, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is in the world to come. He's at the grave, and then while he's weeping, Jesus shows up and he calls Lazarus, and Lazarus comes forth just like the Lord called him. And my sisters and brothers, it's important that we respond to the call of the Lord. It doesn't matter what's occupying your time. It doesn't matter what your calendar looks like. We ought to respond to the Lord. Lazarus came forth. Lazarus was resurrected from the dead. Are you with me today? He truly was sick. We don't have to deny our sickness. When we are sick, we sick. We get sick. Hey, man, I'm sick. How you doing, man? I'm sick. Not because Jesus doesn't have the power to heal me and to restore me, but right now I'm not doing good. You're not less than a Christian for admitting you're hurting. So many bottle up their feelings, their emotions, and their hurts, because if I tell somebody that I'm hurting, they're going to think that I'm a weak person. I'm less than a man. I'm less than a woman. How can I be a Christian if I'm telling people that I'm hurting? I'm supposed to be helping other people. And then there's the long-term hurt that continues to be bottled up because somebody told me that as a Christian, I wasn't supposed to be hurting. I wasn't supposed to express my feeling, my true feeling. All of us can say, how you doing? I'm doing fine. Blessed and highly favored. Sometimes it's okay to say I'm hurting, I'm sick. But it's good to know that we can trust in Jesus. Lazarus was resurrected, came forward with grave clothes on, and the Bible says as a result of Jesus waiting 4 days after he had died, other people surrounded. It was for the benefit of the people that were around that they witnessed that Jesus is the Lord, he is the Messiah, that he called a dead man back to life. And many people believe. But here's the other side of that, y'all. Eventually, Lazarus died again. Eventually, we don't know when, we don't know what his sickness was, but eventually, most likely, he got sick and died again. Now, there was another resurrection. Now, Jesus went to the cross. Anybody know that story? Jesus was falsely accused. And he had been healing people and helping people, calling babies to him and blessing them, healing the blind and restoring sight to the blind, giving healing to people who couldn't hear. Even a man that Peter had cut off his ear, he took his ear and put it back on the man. Not only that, but he was forgiving sin. Praise the Lord, he forgave my sin. Bless the Lord. When I didn't even feel worthy to stand before people, he forgave my sins. When I thought I had messed up my life so much, how dare God could use a wretch like me? He forgave my sins. And I learned that I didn't have to get myself together. I didn't have to be this perfect person, that I could come to Jesus just as I was, and I could allow him to cleanse me. And that cleansing is still working on me. That cleansing is still a process. I've been forgiven. I've been redeemed. But he's still working in me and working on me. And if you're honest, he's still working in you. And those of you who are still wondering if this is the way, you don't have to follow Jesus as a perfect person. You can bring your sins and your cares and your concerns to the Lord. Things that you're ashamed to tell everybody else, the Lord already knows about it. He loves you with an unconditional love. This same Jesus went to the cross for your sins. You couldn't go to the cross for your sins, and I couldn't go to the cross for my sin, but Jesus took on all of our sins. And while he's on the cross, he's still forgiving people. He says, Lord, Father, they're ignorant. By the way, ignorant is not a bad word. It's just they don't even know. They don't know what they're doing. They don't know that they're crucifying the Savior of the world. They don't realize that I came to set the captive free. They don't know that I came to give them eternal life, and they're the one that's saying, crucify him. So God, forgive them. While he was on the cross, he told one of the thieves that was about to enter into eternal damnation, when he cried out to him just to remember him, he says, today you will be with me in paradise. He was ministering. He was saving. He was set free those last few moments on the cross before he went to the grave. This same Savior was beaten. And this same Savior that thorns were pressed down on his head. This same Savior where blood was streaming down his face. This same Savior who was beaten beyond recognition. They didn't even know who was on the cross if they didn't get there in the beginning. This same Savior. But he had already told them, if you tear this temple down, 3 days it'll be raised up again. He died for your sins and mine. That seemed like the end of the story, but aren't you grateful that that's not the end of the story? Because the scripture says 3 days later, they came to the tomb where Jesus was buried, and the tomb was empty. Unlike Lazarus, the grave clothes were still in the grave. But Jesus, the Savior, had been resurrected from the grave with power. And that same Holy Ghost power believers receive when they embrace Jesus as Lord. He died. He died for your sins. He was buried in this borrowed tomb. But thank God, the third day he rose from the grave. And here's the good news, church. Unlike Lazarus, he didn't die again. Didn't go to the grave, didn't go to the cross again. Even though we sin, we fall short. He says, I only went to the cross once, and that was it. He finished what he came to do. He didn't do like me, got tired and quit. He didn't do like me, took the card and checked out. He didn't do like me, didn't think that things were going his way. He died on the cross. He's died and he rose from the grave. He finished what he came to do. And we ought to finish what he has sent us to do. Sometimes tired, sometimes weary, sometimes brokenhearted, but finish what he sent you to do. Sometimes sick, and sometimes tired, and sometimes tired, and sometimes sick, but finish what he sent you to do. Sometimes misunderstood, and sometimes people being offensive to you, sometimes you offending other people, but finish what he sent you to do. Sometimes we don't understand why we have to wait, but we should finish what he has sent us to do. Waiting is not a bad thing as long as we're waiting on the Lord. And waiting doesn't mean that we're idle. We are waiting while we're working the work that the Lord has sent us to do. Finish what he sent you to do. If you started, finish what he sent you to do. A delayed response to not give up. He finished what he came to do. And I'm so glad that every day we can go to him, because he knows what we are going through. Whatever the agony, the pain, the disappointment, he has already experienced it. Whatever the temptation is, he has already experienced it. But he finished the work. Aren't you grateful that the Lord finished? He didn't quit. He didn't throw in the towel. He didn't give up, but he finished, and he was resurrected, and he lives today, and he will return for his church without a spot or a wrinkle. Praise the Lord. Won't you stand on your feet? Won't you stand on your feet? Stand on your feet. And this is another day that God has called us to trust him. Our sister's going to minister to us, and if you're ready to make that commitment, why don't you be bold enough to trust him? You know he's called you. If you made that commitment to follow him, we welcome you. We welcome you. Even as she sings, you can come. You can come.
He finished his work. Praise God for the death, burial, resurrection of his son, our Lord Jesus Christ. He is risen. He is risen. He is risen. You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. Yeah. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life. Yeah. So I can be free. So I can be whole. So I can tell everyone I know.
Change my life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on, thank the Lord for Sister Janine. Bless his holy name. Wonderful, wonderful. Yeah, he had you in mind when he went to the cross. And he had us in mind. Bless his holy name. Come on, church. Come on. Let's just thank the Lord for this day. Thank him again. Thank him again. Over and over for all the wonderful things that he continues to do. Yeah, Lord. Bless his holy name. Wonderful Savior. Our God, our everlasting Father. God, we just bless you again in this place. We just celebrate your goodness. You are a wonderful God. And we just bless your people, oh God, whatever they're facing, God, we bring them before you. Thank you, God, for strength. Thank you for wisdom. Thank you for your power. Thank you for being a comforter. Thank you, God, for being a healer, that all sickness is not unto death, oh God. To you be the glory. In Jesus' name, the people shouted hallelujah again. Hallelujah, hallelujah, and amen. We bless the Lord. What a wonderful time. As we continue in worship, our ushers are going to come and lead us as we continue in worship. And we ask God's blessing, those who are worshiping. Praise the Lord. Yeah, what a wonderful Savior. We have been blessed beyond our imagination from the Lord on high. We didn't deserve it. We didn't earn it. But the Lord blessed us in spite of us. And we can shout glory to the Lord God Almighty. God bless your people as we give, as only you can. To you be the glory. In Jesus' name, let us continue to worship God even as we bring our gifts to the Lord. Our ushers will help us, those who need to walk, those who will be given by Givelify, you're able to do that. Those who are given, who are walking, we ask that you stand at this time.
Good morning, Fresh Visions. I'm sorry. Good morning, Fresh Visions. Good morning. Come on. Happy Easter. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Yes. So on behalf of my church family, we thank you for visiting us, and that we hope that you come back again. A couple announcements. So one, there's no Bible study this week. The lights will be off. The building will be shut down. We will not be here. No Bible study. One upcoming event, the Christian Education Retreat. They'll be covering teaching tools and self-discipline struggle. So that is April 13th on Saturday at the Northfield Inn. Dr. Elsie Sutton will be teaching. And I'd also like to introduce the Reverend Robert L. Jones Jr. Community Mission and Giving Program. Yeah. Yes. So if you knew my dad, not only would he take off the clothes off his back, but he would give you a message to match the clothing. So it's an honor to have a program named after him. And for the last 10 years, Fresh Visions have granted $100,000 to local nonprofit nominations. So that is amazing. So nominations for that is due April 13th, 2024. And also, if you are continually interested in doing more good things with Fresh Visions, join the advisory committee so you can complete an interest form at the Welcome Center by April 14th as well. And if you need a ride to church, you can call that number that I'm hoping that will show up soon, or the email to church and leave your information to receive a ride. Again, I'd like to greet our visitors and thank you for spending Easter with us.
Thank you. Again, we say thank you. Thank you so much. All of our visitors, thank you so much for worshiping with us. All of our friends and family members, thank you. Thank you for being with your family, being with your friend, or if you just decided to stop in. I think Jackie and I, we're going to try to get to the back of the church to catch some of you before you go. Brother Ozzie, I'm going to let Brother Ozzie dismiss us in prayer and benediction. I'll bring it to you if need be. Thank you all so much. And will you stand and make sure that you greet someone before you leave this place. Amen. Reverend. All right. We're
going to walk to the back. Okay. Oh, what a wonderful day this has been. Wonderful day. So when we think about what God, through his son Jesus Christ, has done for us, we can't do nothing but shout and say, glory, 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 hallelujah. Father God, we once again give you praise, give you honor, give you glory. Thanking you for all that you made available to us, Lord, through the death, the burial, and the resurrection of your son, Jesus Christ. Lord, as we celebrate this day with family and friends, talk on telephones, Lord, to relatives far away, we just want to give you praise, honor, and glory for all the things you've done and continue to do. Greetings to all. A great week coming. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.